Good.
Good.
Just good.
Great.
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 We should be great because we serve a great God. Yeah, today's, this week's been really a busy week, and I've been kind of worn out. In fact, you know, I was sleeping this morning, and Anita gets up and says, "Aren't you going to the Berean Church for that Passover thing?" And I said, "What time is it?" And she said, "It's like 8:45. I looked at my phone and had set my alarm for 7:00 p.m. I would have been sleeping for a long time. It wasn't for my wife. So thank you for getting me up, and I really enjoyed that. God is a great God. But the thing is, sometimes in life, we don't, I guess, realize, or we don't focus on how great our God is. You know what I'm saying? Because we go through our daily lives, and you know, we get up in the morning and we go out about our daily duties, and pretty soon we tend to even forget that God even exists, because we don't put Him as a priority in our lives. We don't put Him number one in our lives. And then we go about life, and then we find out that things just don't go right when we don't put God number one in our lives. And so today we're going to focus on how great, how awesome. There's no words that can really express how great our God is and what He has done for us. I've been watching, you know, even though I've been working late trying to get things taken care of with this furnace and air conditioning unit, a lot of times working past midnight, I take a shower and then I'm eating dinner past midnight. I like to watch this movie called Undercover Boss. How many of you have seen that before? Any of you? It's a really neat story on how a CEO, a big wig in a company, goes undercover, and he becomes one of the employees, working with the employees, just to kind of figure out how things are operating and how things run in his own company. And it is an eye-opener for the CEOs who are sort of out of touch with their workers and their employees. And so when they go undercover, you know, they actually, you know, like, this is the CEO, Sheldon, and he puts a little makeup on so that they don't recognize him. And he is a CEO of Belfort, which is a cleaning and restoration company. It's one of the world's largest restoration companies. So if there's a fire or flooding, they go in there and they completely restore the house back to its an original condition. And one of the things that he was doing is he went and he was supposed to strip all the insulation out, the wet insulation, and some of you know what it's like to take or do, you know, before construction can start, when you have a restoration project, there's destruction that has to happen. And so he had to help hang sheetrock. Now, how many of you ever hung sheetrock before? Without a jack on the ceiling, you know? And you have two people, right? And you're holding it up there, and the other hand, you got your drill trying to get that screw in. You know, he's over there, and that he couldn't get, and he got so frustrated, he just got upset, and he says, you know, I'm gonna quit. I can't do this. And here's the boss of the company, and he can't do the simple work of hanging sheetrock. And then this other one, he has another job. He goes, what they have to do is they have to crawl in this crawl space under the house because it's flooding. They have to take all this wet insulation. Now, wet insulation is bad enough, all it is, right? But can you imagine crawling underneath where it's flooded or, you know, water? So they're wearing this I don't know why they have white suits, but a white coverall, and they're crawling under, and he's supposed to take all this wet insulation, crawling in this mud, and he was just like, this is disgusting. And he talks, a lot of these employers talk with their employees and kind of find out about what's going on in their life. And this lady says, you know, I like working for this company, but you know, they promise us raises and they don't give us the raise and all this. Of course, at the end, what he does is he calls these employees and he's portraying that he's doing a reality TV show to basically go undercover so he can kind of figure out what's going on in the company. And so he calls the employees into his office and he says, you know, I am the CEO. Because, you know, they're over there, you look familiar. And he had worked with them the past week. And when he shared with them how much his life was changed because of what they were going through and how out of touch he as the CEO was with the employees, and just tears just came down his face and says, I'm never gonna take you guys for granted again. And the reason why I bring that up is because we have a CEO, a God, that knows us intimately. He's not separated, a God up here and you're down there. And you know how many of you have thought, God has no idea what I'm going through. Huh? But we have a person that cares intimately for each and every one of us, none excluded. That he loves us so much, okay? That he was willing. Now these CEOs, a lot of times at the end, since they hear their sob stories, you know, well, my daughter's got leukemia, or I'm trying to send my kids to school, but I can't afford to. I'm working two jobs and all this, and he's hearing all this. And at the end of all these episodes, the CEO usually says, you know what we're gonna do, and this guy, he says, I'm gonna give you $15,000 to help you out of debt. And each of the employees, he was giving $15,000. And he was saying how, you know, I have no clue, because I live in a different world. I'm rich, I don't have to worry about where the next paycheck's coming from. And in here, I understand, now I understand that you guys are struggling just to make ends meet. And I'm here sitting in my house, my fancy mansion, and I am out of touch with what you go through. God knows every hurt, sorrow, anything that we're going through, he knows you. And he wants you to bring these things to him. And the thing is that he listens. Sometimes employees of a great company will send emails or even confront the CEO directly and say, hey, this is going on. Can you do something about it? They kind of slough him off. But you know, when we go to our CEO, our God, he is so great that he takes the time. He already knows about it. He takes the time and say, come, climb up on my lap. I want to hear about your sorrows. I want to hear about your problems. Because I actually care for you. Do you believe that? That God really cares for us where he wants to bring us to himself. We have a God who, when we stray away, when we run away from him, he is pursuing us. He's saying, come back here. Come to me. Right, Jesus? Come unto me, you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Wow. Why is it that we run away from resting in our God? Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise him. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of stars, and he calls them each by name. Wow, can you imagine? How many of you look up in the skies and see the billions of stars? How many of you know some of the stars' names? Maybe one or two. The sun. We all know the sun, right? So at least you know one. But God knows each one by name, and they're only things that he created that have no life, as far as life that we have, a spirit. And if God knows the names of the stars in the universe, how much more does he care about you and knows you by name? Great is our Lord and mighty in his power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise and make music to our God on the harp. He covers the skies with clouds and he supplies the earth with rain and makes grass grow on the hills. How many of you like that moisture that we just had? Huh? Some of you were complaining, oh, it's snowing again. You know, we can complain about things, or we can give praise to God, because all things work together for our good, to those who love God, and to those who are called according to his purpose. I'm pretty sure the farmers and the ranchers appreciate the moisture. It's a lot better than having a drought again. He provides food for the cattle and the young ravens when they call. His pleasure is not in the strength of the horse, nor his delight in the legs of the warrior. The Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love. Extol the Lord, Jerusalem, praise your God, Zion. He strengthens the bars of the gates and blesses your people within you. He grants peace to your borders and satisfies you with the finest of wheat. He sends his command to the earth. His word runs swiftly. And you see, all the great nations of the world, when they became great, they honored God in their lives. But when they started forsaking God, it's like, God, we don't need you anymore. We can do it on our own. And what happens? That's when the nation starts to fall. Many nations have fallen because of within. Not because of an enemy attacking them, but from within, the corruption, the evil that takes place. Because why? Because they fail to acknowledge the great God that wants to be involved in their lives. And when we look at America today, America became great because they acknowledged Jesus Christ as God, the Creator. That's what made America great. And we all know that America is kind of falling apart today. Why? Because we have invited people from all over the world to bring in their gods. And we have to say, oh, their gods are equal to our God. Equal rights. And how God must be disgusted, because he says there is no other God. I am the only one. Don't go running after other gods. I am a jealous God. I know that there's none other beside me. And I have the best to offer you. Why go looking for other gods? In the same way, in our individual lives, we must realize that nothing else can take the place, the God-created place in our hearts that only he can fill. And people are always chasing after other things to fill that void, and trying to fill it. But you know what? They will never be satisfied, because there's only one thing that can satisfy. It's a God hole, God-sized hole, that only he can feel. He spreads the snow like wool and scatters the frost like ashes. He hurls down his hail like pebbles. Who can withstand his icy blast? He sends the word and melts them. He stirs up his breezes and the water flow. He has revealed his word to Jacob, his laws and decrees to Israel. He has done this for no other nation. Why? Because they do not know his laws, his commands, his ways. Praise the Lord. You understand that as individual people, if we don't acknowledge God for who he is, and if we do not follow his ways, keep his commands, keep his precepts, keep his laws, we're going to be like the other nations, and we're going to fall away from him. We must turn as a nation, as individuals, back to God, who is a great God. In Jeremiah 10, it says, hear what the Lord says to you, people of Israel. This is what the Lord says. Do not learn the ways of the nations or be terrified by signs in the heavens, though the nations are terrified by them. For the practices of the peoples are worthless. They cut a tree out of the forest and the craftsman shapes it with his chisel. And they adorn it with silver and gold and they fasten it with a hammer and nails so that it would not totter. Like a scarecrow. This is something that I didn't know, that they had scarecrows way back then. Like a scarecrow in a cucumber field. Their idols cannot speak. They must be carried because they cannot walk. Do not fear them. They can do no harm, nor can they do any good. No one is like you, Lord. You are great, and your name is mighty in power. Who should not fear you, King of nations? This is your due. Among all the wise leaders of the nations and all their kingdoms, there is no one like you. They are all senseless and foolish. They are taught by worthless wooden idols. Hammered silver is brought from Tarshish and gold from Upshot. What the craftsmen and goldsmiths have made is then dressed in blue and purple, all made by skilled workers. But the Lord is the true God. He is the living God, the eternal King. And when he is angry, then the earth trembles. The nations cannot endure his wrath. Tell them this. These gods who did not make the heavens and the earth will perish from the earth and from under the heavens. But God made the earth by his power. He founded the word by his wisdom and stretched out the heavens by his understanding. And when he thunders, the waters in the heavens roar, and he makes the clouds rise from the ends of the earth, and he sends lightning with the rain and brings out the wind from his storehouses. Everyone is senseless and without knowledge, and every goldsmith is shamed by his idols. The images he makes are fraud. They have no breath in them. They are worthless. The objects of mockery, and when their judgment comes, they will perish. He who is the portion of Jacob is not like these. For he is the maker of all things, including Israel, the people of his inheritance. The Lord Almighty is his here, the Lord Almighty is showing the Hebrew people that he wants to free them from their bondage. And they're all excited about leaving Egypt, right? And so they get on their way and they get hemmed in by the sea. And they says, oh, we should have gone back to Egypt. But we had it good.